Last lecture on colloids, and since I've given you all this background about how they work and their various interactions, I thought what I'd do for this last one is give you something that's current research. And this is research that's going on in my lab at New York. I'm going to try to take it at a gentle pace, and I'm happy to be interrupted with questions, all right? So please do interrupt me as we go along. That doesn't bother me at all. I have more material here. I probably have enough material here that I can keep you here for 2 hours or longer, all right? So how much of it we cover doesn't really matter. All right, so one of the things that people are trying to do with colloids these days is to build new structures. Yes? My volume's very low. How about now? Is that good? A little higher in the back, they say. How about now? Nope. What?
Do you need a fan? You can switch up the fan, then it...
Huh? Does that make a noise? I can't tell.
Yeah.
No,
it's on.
Yeah, all right, how about now? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
If I talk like this, I'll try and talk loudly. How's that? All right, so here we go. So one of the things that we're trying to figure out how to do with colloids is to build different structures. So what I show here is three pictures of various structures made out of Lego. They're not the real thing. We have Big Ben here on the right. We have a nice cathedral from Barcelona in the middle, and a building from Red Square in Moscow. So these are nice things you can build with Lego. And so what we're thinking is we would like to be able to rival Lego with our colloids and make different structures. So these would be microscopic structures where the building blocks, the units, instead of being centimeters in size, would be microns or hundreds of nanometers in size. And the idea is to try and learn how to put colloids together in as arbitrary a fashion as possible. But of course, we want to be able to program it, all right? So that's a goal. There's a lot of fantasy out there, but with some developments, particularly in DNA-coded colloids over the last 10 years, the fantasies are looking more and more like they might be realizable. So I thought I'd tell you about at least our take on this from my laboratory in New York. So what we're really trying to do in some sense is to develop a new kind of material science where the building blocks are colloids and the glue that holds them together is DNA. So there's a few things that we're trying to keep in mind. First of all, we don't want to build DNA structures per se. There is a large part of the research community who has devoted themselves just to making really cool structures out of DNA. But that's not what our purpose is. We want to make structures out of different materials and just use the DNA as glue. So just like when you glue some pieces of wood together to make something, you want the something you're making to be made out of wood and glue just to be a tiny fraction of the material. Its only purpose is to hold the wood together. So we want to keep that in mind. We want the majority components to be the materials that we're making the stuff out of. The other thing, another important thing that works in our favor is something I talked about yesterday, namely that you can make colloids out of almost anything. So you can make them out of plastics, out of inorganics, out of metals, out of semiconductors. So you can imagine putting these different things together. It could, and the idea is that the structures we might like to make eventually would be heterogeneous. That is, it wouldn't be all gold or all polystyrene or all silica. It would be a mixture of those things put together in a predetermined, rational way, so that we would program the assembly from the ground up. The idea would be to take our particles, throw them in a beaker of water, come back in an hour, and there's Big Ben, all right? Or at least Little Ben, maybe. But that's the idea. All right, so we start with DNA. So if you've ever read the book Double Helix by James Watson, you know that when he and Francis Crick figured out the structure of DNA, he went to a neighborhood bar and announced that they had discovered the secret of life. All right, so that was some 60-odd years ago. So I want to just remind you about a few of the properties of DNA. DNA, is a double helix that has a backbone, and off the backbone are these bases. I listed them here, I think. So you have four bases: adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine, or just A, C, G, and T, as they're shown here. The thing to remember about them is that G likes to pair up with C, and T likes to pair up with A. And attaching the two strands to each other. Now, the sequence of G, C's, T's, and A's is what's known as the genetic code, because it turns out that this DNA will code for the production of different kinds of proteins. Now, that's their biological function. We're not interested in that at all, all right? But that's the way they're used by biological organisms. So you just have to remember you have TA and GC. Those are the things that like to code. And two strands will bind to each other when they have complementary codes that match each other. So the GT, AT is matched by the AT, AC on this one. So they have complementary codes and they bind together. All right, so that's what you need to know. Now, my colleague Ned Seaman is really the father of this area of DNA nanotechnology, and as he likes to say, DNA is not merely the secret of life. It's good for other things too. And in particular, he's the one who pioneered the idea of DNA as a structural material. All right, so no biology here, just as a material out of which you can build some fairly exotic structures. So here's an example from a paper he published some dozen years ago. He starts out and introduces into a beaker four short strands of DNA. Now I should sort of back up here. So these four strands might have on the order, I'd have to look it up, but on the order of maybe 16 or so bases on it. So it's a short strand of DNA. These days, you can actually go to the web and type in the letters you want, G, C, T, A, in the particular sequence, give them your credit card number, press a button, and then a few days later, the DNA shows up in your laboratory. All right, so that's how we synthesize it, all right? We synthesize it with a little bit of money and the web, all right? So it's really rather easy to do. But here you have four of them. And the way he programmed them, the green part of the green, this part here paired with this part of the red, and this part of the green paired with this part of this pinkish strand. All right, but then there were a few bases left out here unpaired. Similarly for the other four strands. So you have four different strands, and this is the way they pair up based on their sequence of bases. All right, so that's step one. Step two, all right, so those are the paired bases I show there, and these unpaired bases we call sticky ends. All right, and you'll see why in a second. Because once you have these, the way he programmed it is he made this sticky end complementary to this sticky end, and this sticky end complementary to that sticky end. All right? So now, pardon?
What's the center?
Nothing's in the center. The DNA just makes a corner like that. The DNA strand just bends, and there's nothing in the center. It's all DNA. It's 100% DNA, nothing else. Other questions? Pardon? Well, so here, watch what he does. So with sticky ends programmed this way, you make a bigger structure. So there's a sort of hierarchy in this self-assembly, all right? And then actually he has a few more that hook up to these, and eventually he's able to make a cube like this, all right? So you actually make that. And all you do is you program the sticky ends so that they'll make that. Then you throw the single strands into a beaker of water, and then you come back in 20 minutes and look at it with an AFM. All right? And it actually makes those structures. Now, this is what people could do a dozen years ago. But as such, this is just fun and games. All right? Ned actually has something more than fun and games in mind, although he's not averse to fun and games. One thing he liked to do is the following thing. He liked to make a DNA scaffold. So this scaffolding I show here, not in detail, is the idea is that's made out of DNA, just like this. All right. And then he makes sort of cavities in here that are large enough for a protein to fit into. And then he makes binding points on the DNA that will bind to a specific part of the protein. All right? Then the idea is that the protein should bind to that same part everywhere in the crystal. If he could do this, this would be absolutely wonderful, because the way we know what the structure of DNA, what the structure of proteins are, is by crystallizing them. We crystallize them, you do X-ray diffraction, and from that, you figure out what the structure of the protein is. The problem is most proteins don't crystallize on their own. They have a bizarre shape. They weren't made from an evolutionary point of view to crystallize. That wasn't their purpose. And so the vast majority of proteins don't crystallize, and therefore, we don't know their structure in great detail. So his idea here is he'd make a DNA scaffolding that would come in and have proteins dock and form a crystal because of their interaction with the DNA. Then you could do X-ray scattering on that, and that way you could determine the structure of any protein. All right, so that's sort of a nice idea. There are other things. This is a really a cool idea that was done about 10 years ago. It's called DNA origami. All right, so the idea of DNA origami is this. You take actually a naturally occurring DNA, lambda DNA, you get it from bugs. It's very long, all right? But we know the sequence of bases, the entire sequence of bases. And then what you do is you stick in little short strands of DNA, half of which will bind to some bases over here, and the other half which will bind to bases over here. And they'll link those two pieces of the long strand together. So these are called, in the lingo used in this business, these are called staples because they attach these two points. All right. So what Paul Ruthemond did about 10 years ago is he took this lambda phage DNA, and then he said, then he designed a whole bunch of staple strands that he put in so that this long piece of DNA would fold up into some complicated pattern. And then to prove that he could do anything he wanted with this technique, he made various structures. For instance, he made a star structure. This is the design. This is the realization. He made a smiley face. All right. This is the smiley face you made. This distance here is 100 nanometers. So this is like the world's smallest smiley face. All right. And he made other patterns as well. And people are now using this to make all sorts of DNA patterns. And it's sort of expanded to other uses as well. But this is just to show you the power of this approach. People ask, why do you use DNA? We use DNA because really we don't know of any other material that works so well in this way, where you can program it to assemble in very sophisticated ways. There actually are a few synthetic variants on DNA. For example, there's something called a morpholino, and a morpholino is essentially DNA, but the backbone of the DNA isn't charged, of the morpholino isn't charged. In normal DNA, the backbone's charged. But those are more expensive than regular DNA. All right. Yes?
So if you start with basic ingredients and want to make a crystal, so how do you actually do it? And you just put them and they self-assemble, or you have to do
You mean in this application here?
No, just want a regular crystal.
Just making a regular crystal? Well, you have to program the structure you want by choosing the DNA sequences and having some design in mind. But once you have that, you just throw them in a jar of water and they assemble themselves.
You don't have to do it slowly or something?
Not particularly. It's surprisingly robust. All right. That's not to say it always works. You know, there are designs people try that don't work, and then they sort of think about it and they realize that there was something wrong with their design, and then they fix it up. So it does take, it sometimes takes a bit of tinkering to get it to work. But once you get it to work, you simply throw it in the jar and it assembles itself 100% on its own. No help, no outside help. All right.
So how many strands did it take to make the star or the
star? I think that the different colors here, 1, 2, 3, wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I guess there are 5 colors there. So I think probably 5 DNA, you know, these long lambda DNAs. And then they themselves are stapled together, all right? So so people are making, people are really just beginning to make practical use of this. It's called DNA origami. So if you hear anybody talking about DNA origami, this is what they're talking about. Okay, so the thing I want you to take away from this, these single-stranded DNA overhangs, we say sometimes they come in 4 flavors, G, C, T, and A. What we'll say is that the overhangs come in 4 flavors. In other words, each of these overhangs has a different code. And for some reason, people tend to call those flavors. I don't know why. But just so you know the jargon. And so you can code these up any way you want. We have used sticky ends that consist of anywhere from 4 to about 15 bases. All right, so not many. All right, so we're interested in using this technology as programmable glue. Let me just tell you or remind you maybe of a few of the properties of DNA. DNA is a polyelectrolyte, that is, it's highly charged. As such, DNA molecules thrown into water without any salt will repel each other and they'll never see each other, they'll never form a double helix. So what you have to do, apropos of our discussion yesterday, is you have to put in some salt. We generally work at about 100 millimolar of sodium chloride. That's sufficient to screen the Coulomb repulsion between the strands so that the bases can come together and attach to each other. By the way, when they attach to each other, people refer to that as hybridization. All right, so they hybridize. Just means that complementary bases bind to each other. That's one thing to keep in mind. We work sometimes with double-stranded DNA, sometimes with single-stranded DNA. It's important to understand that the physical properties of the two are quite different. Double-stranded DNA at these concentrations has a persistence length of about 50 nanometers. What I mean by that is you have this strand of DNA, all right, and it won't make bends with a turning radius of much less than 50 nanometers, all right? And that's in part due to the fact, or it's due largely to the fact that it's a double strand and it's hard to bend. By contrast, the single-stranded DNA is considerably more flexible. It generally has a persistence length of a few nanometers. Now, this persistence length, particularly of single-stranded DNA, but also double-stranded DNA, depends on the salt concentration. Why? Because because the backbone is charged, you can get charge interactions. The charges come closer to each other when the DNA backbone bends. And so, in fact, the charging largely determines what the stiffness is, particularly of the single-stranded DNA. At the conditions we work at of 100 millimolar salt, the persistence length is about 2.5 nanometers. All right, so the other things keep in mind, you'll sometimes see people quote the distance between bases or nucleotides, which is what each monomer unit is called, is 0.33 nanometers. That's in double-stranded DNA going up the axis. Actually, the distance between them just along the axis for single-stranded DNA is about 0.63 nanometers. So that gives you a sense of the scales that we're talking about. All right, so the assembly of colloidal particles using colloidal particles coated with DNA was pioneered by two groups, one led by Chad Merkin at Northwestern University and one led by Paul Alavisados at Berkeley. And they published their first paper on this back in 1996. And what they did was they had gold nanoparticles and they attached DNA, double-stranded DNA to it with a sticky end. Here's sort of a close-up to give you a sense of what it looks like. So what they had here was their gold nanoparticle. The DNA is stiff. It's only about 20 nanometers long. So to enable the DNA to move around, because what you're going to want to do is have this DNA on this particle attached to DNA on another particle, you need this to be flexible, so they put a little flexible linker in here. It's made of polyethylene glycol. It's about 4 or 5 monomer units. For those of you who are chemists, it's attached to the gold via a thiol linkage, which is a sort of a standard way of linking things to gold. It's not super strong, but it's strong enough. So what happens is these things can link up. So these sticky ends are programmed to hybridize with the sticky ends on another particle. And you can make crystals this way. Now, they didn't make crystals right away. They didn't figure out how to do that for another 10 years or so. Matter of fact, even longer than that. These papers here, particularly this one, just published 4 years ago, shows how you can make a number of different crystal structures from these DNA-coated gold nanoparticles. All right, now, and you do that with X-ray scattering, all right, because the size of this, the size of the nanoparticle might be anywhere from 5 to 40 nanometers, something in that range, all right? And in this case, the size of the DNA is about the same size as the gold nanoparticle. Sometimes it's a bit bigger, sometimes it's a bit smaller, but it's always comparable in size to the nanoparticles. Now, what that means, if you just do simple geometry, is that the volume occupied by the gold is very small. If you just go through it all and do your little calculation, if the length of the DNA is equal to the diameter of the particles, then the particles occupy less than 2% of the total volume. All right? The rest of it is occupied by water and DNA. All right, so this doesn't meet my self-set criterion of having the glue be the minority component, because here the component, the colloid, just constitutes 2% of the sample. All right, but these people worked out a lot of the ideas and technology about how to hook particles together using DNA coatings. So this is what our particles look like. All right. Over here, I've drawn things to scale. So this is our colloid, a 1 micron colloid, and it doesn't fit on the screen so that I can show you the DNA. All right, so here's the DNA on the surface. So this is the DNA we have. It typically consists of about 50 or so bases. That translates into a length of about 20 nanometers. All right. Remember, the persistence length is 50 nanometers, so on a length scale of 20 nanometers, it's going to be very stiff, more or less like a straight rod. We have single-stranded sticky ends on the order of 10 bases, give or take a few. All right. We attach the DNA to our particles using proteins, all right? So we use this protein represented in blue is supposed to be biotin. The one in green is called streptavidin, and then there's another biotin here. This is a commonly used technique. Biologists pioneered this, and we physicists have just followed their lead. These kinds of proteins are readily available. Biotin and streptavidin bind to each other with a sort of classic lock and key interaction. It's actually a very, as protein binding goes, it's a very strong bond. It's not a covalent bond, but it's stronger than almost all other protein-protein bonds. So that tends to be more than strong enough to make the DNA adhere to the polystyrene particles. So what you can do is you can buy polystyrene with biotin already on it. And then you can buy DNA with this biotin streptavidin linker already on it. So this is why we physicists did this, all right, because we didn't want to get involved in too much chemistry. All right. I'll show you later on how that got us into a little bit of trouble. All right. But at least initially, it was a nice thing to do, and it works out okay. All right. So using this, you can attach it. Also, we have a flexible linker just like the other guys did there, so that these things can wave around in the breeze. Then the other thing, and I'll come back to this in a second, is you see over here we have a polymer brush. The polymer brush is made from what's known as a pleuronic surfactant. It's designated as F127. People who work with colloids and surfactants will know this surfactant. It's a very versatile and popular one. It's made up of, it's actually a tri-block polymer. The outer, one outer block is polyethylene oxide. That's a water-soluble polymer. The next block is polypropylene oxide that doesn't like water. And then the last one is another block of polyethylene oxide. So if you throw it in with the colloid, what it will do is it will tend to adsorb onto the colloid surface. So the PPO block will adsorb, and the PEO blocks will stick out into the water, and it will form a polymer brush that will help keep this, the colloids from binding to each other non-specifically. In other words, it will defeat the van der Waals attractive force. All right, so that turns out to be quite important. And it wasn't something we appreciated initially. All right, just to remind you of the length scales, the DNA is about 20 nanometers long. The particle is about 1,000 nanometers in diameter. All right, so just from yesterday, we know that we have several interactions at work here. First, we have a van der Waals interaction that's very strong, and if we don't do anything about it, will cause the particles to aggregate irreversibly. We also have this brush. All right, now, taken together, they make a potential that looks like this. Now, you might ask, if you're using polystyrene, which we are, can't we use the charge stabilization? And the answer is no, we can't. Because in order for the DNA to bind, we have to throw in this 100 millimolar of salt. And that totally destroys the charge stabilization. Charge stabilization won't work in this system because we've thrown in salt so that the DNA won't repel each other. All right. So this is one of the reasons why people have developed this alternative method of stabilizing colloids, is so that you can handle situations like this. All right, so now that comes the DNA interaction. First of all, the DNA can only bind if it's close enough to bind. So say the DNA has a length L. All right, that's the...
Excuse me?
Yeah.
I think I just lost it somewhere. So why did you have to add the chloronic?
To serve as a brush to keep
but
it...
But you also have the DNAs of a fairly long persistent
length. Yeah, but that turns out not to be enough to stabilize it.
Okay.
All right. Yeah, that's a good point. The DNA itself acts like a brush. And to some extent will provide some stability, but it's not sufficient, all right? And that's something we learned the hard way, all right? So now, for the DNA to bind, two particles have to come within twice the length of the DNA of each other. What that means, when they come close to each other, there'll be an overlap area, there'll be a circle where the two particles can have DNA binding to each other, all right? And how big that circle is depends on how close they are to each other. So the closer they are, the bigger that circle is, and the more DNAs that can bind to each other. If you work out the geometry, it's not quite linear, but it's pretty close to linear, all right? Once you make the approximation that the curvature here is much larger than the gap distance. So if you now say, okay, those DNAs can bind to each other, so that acts like an attractive interaction, what you get is something like more or less a linear potential. So when they're bound to each other, you want it to look like this. You have a minimum, you have a barrier that keeps them from aggregating irreversibly, and they stick together in a nice way. That's the idea. Now, you can work out a model of this, which we've done. When DNAs bind to each other, before they bind to each other, they're sitting on the surface, and they can be anywhere they want, like this. Their sticky ends are on the surface of a hemisphere. All right, my hand sweeps out a hemisphere. And the same thing for the ones on the other. Once they bind to each other, just geometry restricts them now to move in a circle. All right, so there's an entropic penalty for binding. And of course, that's just fine, provided that the energy gained from the DNA hybridization is sufficient to offset that loss in entropy. All right, and so, you know, if you have on the order of 8 or 10 bases, that's more than enough binding energy to offset that, and that works. Now, one word about this binding. Here, the way I've shown it here, all the DNAs are bound. In general, that's not the case, all right? So how does it work? Suppose these are the DNAs on the two particles. They come together. Maybe these two bind, all right? My second and fourth fingers bind, all right? Right now, if I take a snapshot, if I look if I could look microscopically at the system a few moments later, these two might not be bound anymore, and other two will be bound. All right. In other words, the binding of any individual one will be something that's on and off. It binds and then it's off. And then it binds and it's off. And actually, they generally spend more time off than on. All right. But in order for the two particles to be bound together, you only need that there's always at least one bridge made between the DNA at all times. As long as that's satisfied, then the two particles are bound to each other. Now, the other thing you should understand is that this DNA hybridization is very temperature dependent. Two DNA strands will come apart if you raise the temperature high enough. How high you have to raise it depends on how many strands there are, or how many bases there are. The more bases there are bound to each other, the higher the temperature is. But almost any DNA will unbind if you raise the temperature to something like 90 degrees. All right. For the strands that we use, if they're all by themselves in solution, they will unbind from each other at around 60 degrees. Because we have typically in a circle like this, we typically have about 100 DNA strands that can reach each other. At lower temperatures, there's always enough bound to each other that the particles remain together. And so what we find, I'll show you some data in a second, is that when you put them together like this, they tend to come apart if you raise the temperature above about 40 degrees, and they come together if you lower the temperature below 40 degrees. All right, so the binding energy is simply given by KT, see there's KT coming in again, times the average number of bonds. So just at the melting temperature, just below the melting temperature, the average number of bonds is of order 1. As you lower the temperature farther and farther below the melting temperature, that average number of bonds increases, all right? And you get stronger and stronger binding. So if you think about that, what that means is that the binding potential between two colloids is a sensitive function of temperature, all right? This is weird, right? That is, when atoms bind to each other, the Coulomb force you don't think of as being as a function of temperature. So your interparticle potential for atoms and molecules is just what it is. It's not a function of temperature, typically, or the dependence on temperature is rather slight. Here, it's an extremely sensitive function of temperature. All right, so you can control the binding energy by turning the temperature knob. All right. So here's thermally reversible aggregation. I don't know if you can see this down here, but what we have is a bunch of DNA-coated colloids, all right? And the temperature is below the melting temperature, and so they've all aggregated. And what they form down here is these diffusion-limited aggregates I showed you the other day. And so then we heat it up. So here's a zoomed-out view. And we heat it up to see if they'll melt. And the thing we're interested in is we want to heat them up so they'll melt, cool them down so they'll come together, heat them up so they'll melt, cool them down. We want to be able to do that many times, all right? That is, and we want to be sure that 100% of the particles come apart and 100% of them bind as we raise and lower the temperature. Otherwise, it's going to wreak havoc on our ability to assemble in a rational way. All right, so these were the first experiments where we got it to work. And what we do is we raise and lower the temperature, low temperature, high temperature, then low again, and then high. And you see when it's high, they all come apart. And when it's low, they form these aggregates. And when it's high, they come apart again. So this actually, that experiment took several hours. You can see about 10,000 minutes. No, seconds, 10,000 seconds, sorry. But this was a big victory for us, all right, because when we first did this, we went to the literature and we read what the biologists told us to do. They said, coat your colloids like this, we coated our colloids like that, and then we put them together, they came together, yay. Then we heat them up and they come apart except for about 10 or 20% of them. About 10 or 20% of them stuck together. All right, the biologists didn't tell us that. When you talk to them, they'll tell you that, but they didn't really tell us that in their papers. The reason is they don't care. They're more interested in the binding than they are in the unbinding, all right, because they want to do their assays. But we care a lot about that. And the problem was that the DNA on the surface all by itself did not provide sufficient steric stabilization. So that's when we hit upon the idea of putting on the pleuronics. And when we put on the pleuronics as a surfactant coating that forms a polymer brush, we got this.
How sensitive would be this, you know, aggregation process if you change the salt in the medium?
Not terribly sensitive. Not terribly sensitive. If you take it down to maybe 30 millimolar from 100 millimolar, the DNA, somewhere around there, the DNA is too charged. And the ends can't get near enough to each other. That's the main worry. Other questions? Okay. This is what a melting curve looks like. All right, the way we measure a melting curve is we count, we look at a picture like I showed you before, and we count the number of singlets. That is, we count the number of unattached DNAs, or unattached particles. And we plot that on the y-axis, and on the x-axis is temperature. So you can see at high temperature, it's 100% singlets. And then as we cool the temperature, everything, and there's no singlets, and they're all in aggregates. And you can see that the melting occurs over a temperature window of about 1 degree, all right? If you did this with just a single strand of DNA out in solution binding, you'd find that this melting curve occurs over a width of about 20 degrees, all right? The reason it's 1 degree is because you have the cooperative behavior of many strands, all right? And you can actually calculate this quantitatively. So one thing we did was we coated our particles with DNA, but then we did it in a funny way. In this sample, all the DNA had sticky ends. In another sample, we put in the same DNA, but 20% of the DNA strands didn't have sticky ends on it. So there are fewer sticky ends. And so what happened was the melting temperature moved down a little bit. 60% it moved down more, 20% it moved down more, or 40% it moved down more, 20% it moved down a lot, and then if you take it much below that, they won't stick to each other anymore. All right, so it depends on the density of the DNA. All right, so now I want to get into, yes?
So how do you tune the slope? You know, it's happening over 1 degree and it happens for all the cells.
Yes. It gets a little bit wider down there. The width is controlled largely, by a couple things. First of all, how many DNAs you have to bind in your sort of circle when they come together. So you can affect that a little bit by changing the density of the DNA. And you can see that this one down at 20% is a little wider than the other. The other way you can affect it a bit is by changing the number of bases in the sticky ends. But you don't have a huge amount of control over that. You can vary it by maybe a factor of two or so. There's some other very clever ways that you can vary it and make it as wide as you want. But they're a little bit complicated for our discussion here. I'd be happy to talk to you about it afterwards if you want to know. It involves using something called toehold displacement. And there's a brilliant paper on this that appeared in Science last year by my former Ph.D. student. So that's how we know it's brilliant. No, at any rate, there's some clever ways of broadening out that temperature. You have competing strands, yeah. And so the competing strands, that allows you to control the width. That's the most effective way that I know of, at least, of controlling the width of the melting. And so it's a very nice trick. And you can get some very interesting behavior that way. All right, but that's sort of, that's for experts, maybe.
So what is the rate at which you change the temperature?
Yes?
The rate at which you change the temperature?
Yeah. Fairly slow. Yeah. Well, actually, we have two ways of doing it, all right? The preferred way of doing it, what we do is we put the sample in a capillary tube on a slide where one end of the slide is at a temperature below the melting temperature, and the other end of the slide is at a temperature above the melting temperature, and we have a linear gradient along there. And so then we just look. And we know the temperature at each place, and then we count at each place, and that's in fact how we do most of those melting curves, because it's much more efficient. You just stick it in, you wait an hour or so for everything to equilibrate, and then you just look at it under the microscope, and you get these nice. You get it one shot, yeah. So that's the efficient way to do it. There are cases where, for technical reasons, you. Can't do it that way, and so then you lower the temperature slowly. You know, you might make it go down a degree, a half hour, or something like that. The main restriction is you have to give the colloidal particles time to diffuse far enough that they can aggregate. All right. So this is what motivated me to get into this business. All right. So. I mentioned this briefly the other day. There's a thing called a photonic band gap that people have been talking about for about 30 years now. And the idea is if you could make a periodic three-dimensional lattice of colloidal particles, then you can calculate, say, the propagation of light through that lattice. We know in certain directions you'll get Bragg scattering, and where you get Bragg scattering, you can get complete reflection. All right, so the light won't propagate through the sample, but because of Bragg reflection, will decay exponentially into the sample. And you can make that by making the contrast in refractive index between the spheres and the background very large. You can make it so that Bragg scattering is very large, and that all the light gets reflected. And the exponential decay length is very, very short, less than a wavelength. All right? So you can do that. The idea of a photonic band gap is that that Bragg scattering should be broad enough in angle so that there might be some range of frequencies or range of light wavelengths where no matter what direction you shine the light on the crystal, it gets reflected back at you. And it's simply the case that in that case, light doesn't propagate through the sample no matter what direction it's going relative to the crystalline axes, and that's called a photonic band gap. So just like you can solve Schrodinger's equation in a periodic potential and get an electronic band gap, all right, say in semiconductors, you can now solve the wave equation, the vector wave equation from Maxwell's equation, for a periodic dielectric. And what you find is that for certain crystal structures, if the refractive index contrast is large enough, you get a range of frequencies where light doesn't propagate through the sample. So here's one such calculation. This is a famous calculation because it shows that there's a fairly wide photonic band gap. So you've probably seen drawings like this for electrons. For electrons down here, it comes in quadratically, right? Because the dispersion relation between omega and k for electrons is quadratic. But for light, it's linear, so it comes in linear here. So it looks a little different. But other than that, it looks pretty much like the band structure calculations you've seen for electrons, and you have this band gap. So this was calculated by Kostas Tsoukalos at Iowa State University and his colleagues. And in this case, the spheres, you don't get a band gap that's very big unless the spheres, you don't get a band gap at all, I don't think, unless the spheres touch each other. All right, so it's not like this. The spheres have to grow big enough that they actually touch each other. When they touch each other, about 34% of the volume is solid spheres, and the rest is air. So a diamond structure is a very open structure, all right? And if you look at it, you also notice that it's tetrahedrally coordinated. So the problem with making colloids that will assemble into this structure is colloids, they're just round, and they have a spherically symmetric potential, and they don't make this structure. If you think about carbon, or silicon for that matter, you have these sp3 hybrid orbitals that have this nice tetrahedral symmetry. And that has everything to do with why carbon will form a nice diamond lattice. So I have to admit one point of embarrassment. This article here was published in 1990. All right. So those of us who work on colloids have known about this for 25 years, but none of us have been able to make a diamond lattice. All right. So it's hard. Either that or we're just not being clever enough. So one thing we'd like to do in my group is build a diamond lattice. So that motivated us to develop particles that look sort of like this. That is, we thought, okay, carbon does it because it has these tetrahedral interactions. We wanted to see if we could make colloids that would have tetrahedral interactions. All right, so now I'm going to show you how we went about doing that. So we start by making colloidal clusters. All right, so I'm going to use almost everything I've talked about in the first three lectures today. So stop me if something doesn't make sense. So over in here, we have water plus a surfactant. All right, it's actually a pleuronic. We always are using pleuronic surfactants. Over in this one, we have toluene, which is a good solvent for polystyrene. Then we have polystyrene spheres, but our polystyrene spheres are cross-linked. If they weren't cross-linked, they would just dissolve into the toluene. But because they're cross-linked, they act like little sponges. They'll absorb some toluene, but they won't fall apart because they're chemically cross-linked together. So it's just like a sponge, and they dissolve in there pretty well. These are acid-terminated. In other words, on the surface of these spheres are acid groups that when you put it in water will dissociate and charge it up. But in toluene, not so. All right, they stay associated with each other. Then what we do is we mix them together and we stir it up and we make an emulsion of toluene droplets in water. And if we're careful about it, we can make it so that each droplet has somewhere between one and maybe a dozen particles in it, all right, with varying populations that we've studied. Then what we do, once we get those droplets, is we suck out the toluene. All right. Now, we can suck out the toluene in two ways. We can do it with osmotic pressure, or we can do it with heat. Typically, we do it both ways. If you heat it up, the toluene evaporates faster than the water, and so what happens is all this toluene goes away, and where you had a droplet with four particles inside, it will get squeezed down and form a tetrahedron. Two particles will form a dumbbell. Now, the thing is, since these things were inside toluene when they came together, the surfaces touched, and by the time the toluene evaporated, these particles here are in their primary van der Waals minimum, attached with a few hundred kT of binding energy. So these things are stuck together permanently. They won't come apart. On the other hand, the particles have charges on their surface, and now that they're in water, they charge up so that this cluster won't combine with this cluster. So they're charge stabilized. So these clusters are stable, we know now, for years. We have some in the refrigerator that we've had for on the order of 10 years now. So these are very stable, very nice things to work with. Here's a film that my students took. This is a toluene droplet. This is water. There are seven spheres inside of here. It's blurry because you're down near the diffraction limit of light. All right, so it's an optical microscope. So this distance is 2 microns. So watch what happens. So you can see the particles moving around inside. They're actually stuck to the interface inside the surface. And as the toluene droplet shrinks, they get more and more crowded. A little pop there, and you can see that all the toluene is almost gone. If you look at it under an electron microscope, you can see it a little bit more clearly. It consists of a ring of 5 particles in a pentagon, and then there's a particle sitting in the center above the plane of the ring, and there's another one on the backside sitting below it. And what's interesting is that every time you have 7 particles inside a droplet, it makes this structure, no exceptions. All right? So what happens with the other side, with the other number of particles? Well, before I show you, I'll show you something interesting here. This guy is a mathematician at Princeton University. Some of you may have heard of him. He's fairly famous. One of the things he's famous for is studying sphere packings. Usually, he studies sphere packings in very high dimensional spaces. All right, but back in the mid 90s. He decided to do it in 3 dimensions. And their criterion for what constitutes an efficient packing is to minimize the second moment of the mass distribution. All right? So you just take a certain number of particles and you ask what configuration of those particles minimizes the second moment of the mass distribution. All right? And that you call the most efficient packing. It's a nice way to do it. It's not the only way to do it, but it is a nice, well-defined way. And these are the packings they get for n equals 2 to 11. And here are the clusters we get for 2 to 11. So you see we get clusters that minimize the second moment of the mass distribution. I'll point out a few of them to you. Here's a tetrahedron. That one we're very interested in. This is an octahedron. And the others all have names, but like this one is called, where is it? This one, yeah, this one's called a pentagonal dipyramid. This is a gyro elongated something dipyramid square. I don't remember. It's been a long time. I used to have all of these memorized. Any rate, it makes these different structures. Next step. Let's focus on the one with 4 particles that makes the tetrahedron. So this is a tetrahedron of polystyrene. We have them suspended in water. We add styrene to the water. The styrene is only mildly soluble in the water. Only a little bit of it goes in. But the styrene loves these polystyrene spheres. So they suck it up, all right, out of the water. And so you keep adding it and you watch under a microscope to see how much it sucks up. And when you reach this stage where all the particles have sucked up this amount such that the tips of the colloids in the tetrahedra poke through this droplet, you stop. All right? And then at that point, you polymerize this styrene. And you make this. So this is polystyrene and this is polystyrene. The difference is this one has surface groups that you can do chemistry on, and this one doesn't. All right, that has to do with the initiator you use to make the polystyrene. Different initiators result in different surface groups, all right? So we have different surface groups on these two things. So the surfaces are chemically different, even though the whole thing is basically polystyrene. And so then, so here, let me show you what everything looks like. This is the SEM, and here's the patchy particles we make. So look at this one here. Here's the tetrahedral cluster, and here you see you have tetrahedrally coordinated patches. So the patches have exactly the same geometry as the clusters from which they were made. Therefore, they're highly symmetric. All right, so we get nice, beautiful patchy particles with symmetrically placed patches on their surface due basically to geometry. Yes?
How do you, in step one, how do you make sure you get all tetrahedral?
Oh, okay. I skipped that, all right, but I can, here, just a second with a little bit. I have it here. We do something called density gradient centrifugation. Have you ever heard of that?
You get bands of...
Yeah, you get bands. All right, so yeah, I'll leave that for you since you're an expert. That works great. Works absolutely great. That was one of those happy circumstances. We didn't know about it, and a friend of mine was visiting the lab, and we told him about this problem. He goes, oh, there's something biologists use, a centrifugate. I don't know how it works. Look it up. And so we looked it up, and then we tried it, and it worked the first time we tried it. Almost nothing we do in my lab works the first time we tried it. This one did, all right? So this was a happy thing. So we can separate them, and we can purify them this way. Okay. So here's our clusters. Now we have to attach DNA to them. Like I said, these patches are chemically different, and I hired a couple chemists. All right, chemists, good. Because this was a part that we had a hard time figuring out, all right? And it turned out to be a little bit delicate. And it turns out that it's a good thing to collaborate with people who are experts and know what they're doing, all right? And so these guys, it's Yufeng Wang and Yu Wang, down there, they figured out how to do it and taught us how to do it. And we've become friends for life because of that. So what they did is they attached DNA to that. And oh, by the way, when you buy this DNA with the streptavidin attached, you can get the streptavidin with a dye incorporated, and you get different color dyes. So what we do is if we make different sticky ends, we use different color dyes in the streptavidin so we can identify which type of sticky end we have. So there's our sticky end. And then here we verified that the DNA went to the right place. So we used a fluorescent microscope, and under a fluorescent microscope, the streptavidin on the particle glowed. And where we had four patches, we saw four places where it glowed green. Three, and so on and so forth. So this turned out to work very well. So we were quite happy with this. So it looks like we have our DNA down on patches. Then what we did was we took two sets of particles that had one patch each. One we did with one sticky end, the other one we did with a complementary sticky end, otherwise identical. We throw them in a beaker and wait. And what we see is dimers. And we only see dimers. We don't see any trimers. If we put in equal amounts, eventually we don't see any singlets. Everything comes together. If we look at the sample under a fluorescent microscope, we see that each dimer consists of a patch that glows green and one that patches a patch that glows red. So this isn't accidental. It's the complementary pairs that are coming together in every case. All right, so we get, that's called Watson-Crick pairing. All right, so we get nice Watson-Crick pairing. So if we can do it with two, we try something a little bit more complicated. Here's one with a two-patch particle and two one-patch particles. And there you can see you get trimers. And again, if you look at it under the fluorescent microscope, you see red-green and green-red attachments there. You can do it with three. You can do it with four. All right, so here, look at this. We sort of have colloidal methane. All right, four patches, and again, the fluorescence bears that out. You can make colloidal polymers. All right, so where you mix two-patch particles, then you get alternating copolymers, and you see it starts out, there's a red one, and it's attached to a green one. There's a red-green, green-red, red-green, green-red, red-green, green. All right, so it's all working very nicely. And here's what it looks like under an optical microscope. You can see these things diffusing around. All right, time for a break. All right, so you might remember the last James Bond movie. It came out in 2012. You might not remember the date. I do. It was October 26th, if you were in Great Britain. it came out in my country 2 weeks later on November 8th. In between the two, there was an issue of a British magazine. And it advertised the new Bond. All right. And if you see down here, if you read down here, it says Sticky particles take colloidal assembly to new levels. All right, so that was our article. My graduate students are very good with PowerPoint, and they made this pretty picture, and Nature liked it. And they came up with this idea of the new Bond. I thought that was quite nice of them. So we were very happy. So this is the old Bond, all right. We like the new Bond better. All right, now, I've held something back, all right? Sort of dirty little secret. Told you how happy we were when we got these DNA-coded particles to bind. The part we're not so happy about is that they make fractal aggregates. We don't want fractal aggregates, we want crystals. Why do they make fractal aggregates? They make fractal aggregates because when they come together and hit each other, they stick there and they won't roll. They're just stuck there, all right? This is bad. If you want to form a crystal, the particles need to make small little rearrangements so that they can, for example, maximize the number of particles that they bind with. That usually lowers the free energy. The more bonds you have, the lower the free energy. And that would be the equilibrium state, but only if the particles can roll. And obviously here, they can't roll. They bind and unbind just fine, but they don't roll. All right, so this is a real problem for us. So at this point, we stopped and we said, okay, what's wrong? How can we fix this problem? So we figured that the main problem had to do with surface roughness. And I'll show you why in a second, but before I justify that assertion, let me just say why we thought the particles were rough. First, there's two reasons. These streptavidin proteins have four binding sites for biotin. And the streptavidin is also a big protein, several nanometers in size. The whole thickness of our layer is only 20 nanometers in size. So if you have a fluctuation just by virtue of where they attach of a couple nanometers out of 10 nanometers, you have a surface of DNA that's effectively rough. The other thing is These particles we buy from a company, and if you look at them under the electron microscope, they don't have the prettiest surfaces. I don't know what the company does to them, but somehow the process of attaching the biotin, I'm guessing, screws up the surfaces. All right, so they're fairly rough. Another thing that we thought could hurt the ability of particles to roll was low aerial coverage of DNA. All right? So we set out to solve both of those problems. But before I tell you about that, let me tell you why we thought that roughness is a problem. Suppose I have two colloids attached. Here's their DNA codings here. There's something different about this interaction that you're not particularly used to. Namely, the number of DNAs available to attach is a countable number, something on the order of 100 or so. All right? But suppose you imagine these two particles rolling through an angle theta like this. Now they're attached in a different patch of DNA. What's the chance that those two patches, this one here and this one here, have the same number of DNAs that combine to each other? The answer is not very high. That is, there are natural fluctuations in the density of DNA on the surface, which means that when they come together, this one might sometimes be able to bind to 105. Down here, maybe it can only bind to 95. All right. So what that means, see if I have, is that this number fluctuates. And if you were to sort of measure the binding energy as a function of theta, you'd find that it's stronger in some places and weaker in other places. So that means that to go from here to here, it has to surmount a barrier. All right. Now, as long as that barrier is small compared to KT, you're fine. All right. But if the roughness is sufficient, what that will do is it'll exacerbate the number of the fluctuation in the number of DNAs that combine, and it will make this big compared to KT. And that's what we thought was going on. Now, the other thing that can exacerbate the number fluctuations is low aerial density. So if you have high aerial density, the fluctuations ought to be smaller. So our strategy was to greatly increase the density of DNA on the surface and to make it so they weren't rough. First thing that meant is get rid of the streptavidin-biotin linkage. Now, the streptavidin-biotin linkage we didn't like for another reason, too. Once you make that linkage, you can't throw your particles in organic solvents because the organic solvents will denature the proteins. All right. So what we wanted to have is a nice covalent bond. So I won't tell you too much about this. There's a chemistry that was developed by the group of Carolyn Bertozzi at Berkeley, called sometimes called copper-free click chemistry. All right, click chemistry has been all the rage in the chemistry community over the last 15, 20 years, and it's a nice kind of chemistry that's very robust, very specific, and operates under very mild chemical conditions. So in this one, usually it involves a metal catalyst. And it turns out that metal catalysts are bad for biological molecules. They tend to damage them. So what Bertozzi did was figured out a reaction that in the same spirit as these metal catalyzed click reactions, but didn't involve the metal catalyst. It's really a lovely a piece of work that she did. It involves the fact that you have this eight-membered ring here. It actually wants to be six. Since there are eight members of the ring, it's under strain, all right? And so it's fairly easily attacked, and the way you set it up, she set it up, is it's attacked by N3 groups, which are called azides, all right? So the azides will attack that group and make this bonding here. So what the idea is this R1 should be a colloidal particle. So we make a colloidal particle covered with azide groups. And this R2 should be DNA. All right. Now, fortunately, we were able to figure out how to coat colloids with azides. All right. So it's each one you have a little bit different strategy, but basically what you do is you put on halide groups, chlorine, bromine, iodine, and then you can exchange out those chlorine or bromine groups for the azide using sodium azide. You just throw in the salt, they replace each other, and you get colloids covered with azides. You can buy DNA with this molecule on it, all right? So that's what we did. and so then you get DNA-coated colloids. They're covalently attached, nice small bonds, all right? Now, here's the interesting thing. With the previous coatings, with the streptavidin-biotin link, the way we typically characterize it is we add the aerial density is we ask how many DNA strands can you get on a 1 micron particle? And the record for that with the streptavidin-biotin link was 18,000. All right, get 18,000 strands on a 1 micron particle. All right. With this new way of doing it, we typically get 100,000 up to 1 million strands per particle. All right. So we increase the number of DNAs on it by an order of magnitude, all right? And we've gotten rid of the roughness because we have this nice, small, covalent bond, all right? So this is what our surfaces look like. You have a sticky end. We're now using single-stranded DNA. We discovered that single-stranded DNA works better than double-stranded DNA. That is a rather lengthy explanation as to exactly why that is, but basically it turns out that the amount of entropy you lose when binding two single-stranded DNAs is much less than the amount of entropy you lose when you bind two stiff DNAs. We think that's the reason, though we haven't proven it yet. So there's our single-stranded DNA. It's attached with this DCBO molecule, and we get typically, we get about 120,000, about an order of magnitude more than previously. All right, so.
Do you have the pleuronic surfactant?
Actually, we do still put pleuronic surfactant on it. It's less necessary, all right? You can, if you don't use it, you'll get a little bit of nonspecific binding, but a rather small amount. So we go ahead and put it on to completely suppress it. In the ones where we get up to 1 million on it, I suspect that we won't need it for those, but we haven't. Actually, to tell you the truth, I shouldn't say it. I can't remember whether the graduate student put on pleuronics or not. All right. My guess is he doesn't need them. All right, so the question is, does it diffuse? So we did an experiment here. We took one of these DNA-coated colloids, and we stuck it into some polystyrene stuck to a glass slide. All right, so it's immobilized there. Then we had another one coated with DNA come and attach to it. And then we see if it diffuses on the surface like that. So we did it for 3 different temperatures. Here's 0.6 degrees below the melting temperature, 1.7 degrees below the melting temperature, and 2.8 degrees below the melting temperature. Remember, the further it is below the melting temperature, the more strongly they bind together. Here's what we see. So the one that's 0.6 degrees below the melting temperature, you see the particle moving around lickety-split. The one that's 1.7, it moves around too, but slower. The one that's 2.8 degrees below gets stuck, but then it comes unstuck, all right? And so it moves around, but it periodically gets stuck. So this indicates that there's still fluctuations in the density of DNA on the surface, and that this can result in things getting stuck. But if you're near enough the melting temperature, those barriers are low enough that it can diffuse fairly freely. if you plot up the mean square displacement as a function of time near the melting temperature, you get a straight line. In other words, R squared is proportional to time, it's classic diffusion. If you lower the temperature, the diffusion coefficient goes down because the binding is stronger. But we also see that it's stuck a little bit. And what that does is that lowers the slope. When we go down to 2.8 degrees below, it's subdiffusive, meaning that the time dependence doesn't increase linearly, but it now increases with a power of 0.7. Now, what I've drawn here is a line corresponding to a distance where the particle has diffused one particle radius. I figure in order for particles to anneal and form a crystal, they have to be able to diffuse at least a particle radius. So I want to know how long does that take to happen. So for this one, it takes 11 seconds. For this one, 2.4 seconds. For this one, it's 11. And for this one, it's 45. Now, if you cool it further, not only does this go down, but the slope gets even lower. And so the time it takes for it to cross that eventually becomes prohibitively long, and particles get stuck again. So in the previous state, basically, the window, my guess is that the window over which the particles actually diffuse is either zero or so small that it can't be accessed experimentally. But here now, we can easily access it. Now, watch this. This is an optical microscope of a fairly dense colloidal suspension of DNA-coated colloids. This is the time we speed up the movie. Now, what you'll see, I'll tell you ahead of time what you're going to see. When you turn it on, if you look closely, you'll see some dark spots emerge and disappear. We've looked closely at those, and we're going to look closer at them in the future. But what they are is they're little crystallites forming and then evaporating. If you know anything about classical nucleation theory, in order to form a crystal, you have to get a nucleus that's big enough for it to grow. Why is that? Because when you form a small crystal, you gain in terms of the bulk free energy, but there's a surface energy that you lose. And so for very small crystals, the surface energy is dominant, and it beats out the volume energy. So you have to grow a crystallite that's big enough to overcome that. So watch what happens here. So you can see little dark spots maybe emerging. So we've already gone 20 minutes. At 45 minutes, something nice happens. One of these dark spots right down here doesn't dissolve, doesn't go away. And as you watch, you begin to see a crystal emerging. All right? Once the students realize it, they move a slide so you can see at the center of the microscope, and a bigger and bigger and bigger crystal grows. All right? Eventually, a few other crystals nucleate, and the whole sample crystallizes. You make these beautiful, beautiful crystals. I don't know how well you can see it back there, but you can see the crystalline planes in these samples. So this is maybe hard to see. This is a single crystal of DNA-coated particles. It is, if you look at it, the planes go like this all the way across. So we can grow single crystals at least a millimeter in diameter, which means 1,000 particles across. I think actually there's no limit to how big we can grow them. It's just a question of over what area we can control the temperature sufficiently well. But we can grow them arbitrarily large. All right, so this is a deep quench. All right, here you're going to get completely different behavior. All right, so let's see. How many of you have ever heard of spinodal decomposition? All right, the experts. All right, you're going to see spinodal decomposition. Then you're going to see some aggregates form that aren't crystalline, some amorphous aggregates form. And then the amorphous aggregates are going to crystallize. So it goes by quickly. There's the spinal decomposition. It's a long wavelength instability that gives you these holes. I'll play it again for you so you can see that again. Boom, there's the spinal decomposition. Then it's initially amorphous, but if you start looking closely, you'll see like there's a little, that's actually crystalline there, all right? And if you wait, the entire sample crystallizes this time, but this time you get little small crystallites all the way through. So instead of getting a few single crystals, you get a gazillion little small single crystals, all right? It just has to do with how deep you quench it. This is sort of a classic picture. If you plot the quench temperature versus the time it takes 5% of the sample to crystallize, 50% or 90%, you get these three different curves. But what you find is that at temperatures near the melting temperature, it takes a long time because it takes a long time for crystals to nucleate, all right? At temperatures far below the melting temperature, it takes a long time because you make amorphous aggregates and it takes a long time for them to rearrange and form crystals. In between, you get a compromise between the two and things speed up quite a bit. This is actually a classical type of curve. People see this for, metals freezing and crystallizing. They see exactly the same looking curves. The only difference is that instead of this being a degree and a half, it's more like 300 or 400 degrees. All right. So here everything is compressed into a very tiny temperature range. So here we have, here's two crystals coming together, all right? And you see they come and eventually they weld themselves together. And right here is a green particle in a red row, all right? It's where it's not supposed to be. It's a defect, all right? And you can see how the defect formed here because we can actually watch the crystallization in real time. How did it form? It was just in the wrong place at the wrong time. When these things happened to come together, it was there. There was no escape route, and so it got stuck there. So what you can see, what you can do with this is that you can now study these kinds of crystallization problems in real time, and you can watch and see how systems crystallize. We can make lots of different crystal structures. If we have particles that are all the same size, and we make the sticky ends palindromes. So do you know what a palindrome is? All right, madam, I'm Adam. Reads the same both ways. Well, you can make codes such that read backwards, they're the complement of the code you have. So that means if all the particles are coded with this, they'll stick to each other. And if you do that with monodispersed particles, you get a face-centered cubic lattice. If you use same size particles but have them with complementary pairs that aren't palindromes, you get a cesium chloride structure, which is actually looks like a BCC, except at the center is a different type. And actually what it corresponds to is two interpenetrating simple cubic lattices, all right? And you can see we get beautiful, beautiful lattices this way. If you change the relative size of the two particles, you can get like this aluminum boride structure or this more complicated structure. We're now working on making ternary crystals, that is having three components. And we want to see how complicated we can get. So we've coded all of these materials with DNA. So people have done this before, but all of these are brand new. So we can coat lots of different materials. Our feeling is we can probably do anything, since these are the ones we wanted to do. And some of them were no work at all. Others took us maybe a month or two to figure out how to coat them with an azide coating. What's interesting now is then you can mix and match at will. So here our sublattices are made up of different materials. One sublattice is polystyrene, another one's silica. In this case, one's polystyrene, one's TPM. We can mix anything we want. All right. Now, previously people have done this based on having particles with different charge. One have a negative charge, one has a positive charge. But obviously you're limited. And your ability to do that. Some particles just come negatively charged, some come positively charged, and so you don't have much as much control over that. Here, we don't care about the properties of the particles themselves, all right? We can coat them with DNA. Once we coat them with DNA, they'll bind to what we tell them to bind to and not to something else. So we can make these hybrid materials with the sublattices made up of different components. Let's see. I think I'll skip this. This is sort of interesting, but it'll take me a while to explain it. I'll just leave it here. We've made these patchy colloids. We've made ones that diffuse and roll, and we can make crystalline materials from a bunch of different materials. So this I regard as just the beginning. In some sense, this is very simplistic, but until very recently, it was something that nobody could do. So now I think that we and I think other groups will try and develop this kind of technology so that we can actually program things to make hopefully anything we want. So let me just ask her there. If you have questions, I can still try and answer them. Yeah.
Just a thought. You talked about this photonic band gap materials. So can the species be played around with and think they can build something like an acoustic band gap material?
Wait, I'm not quite understanding. Speak louder.
Phononic band gap material.
Phononic? Yeah, people have made materials with acoustic band gaps, all right? That was done even back in the 90s. There you're working with bigger particles because the wavelength of sound is larger. And people have made phononic band gap materials. People have made photonic band gap materials at microwave frequencies, because there you can the wavelength is long enough as you can basically go into a machine shop and make your crystal. All right, you don't need self-assembly. People have made two-dimensional photonic band gap crystals in the infrared with semiconductors. All right, so those are some of the things people have done. No one has made a fully three-dimensional photonic band gap in the visible. And so that's sort of what we've set as our goal. It's a way of keeping us focused and that we do all these interesting things that keep us entertained on the side.
How big are these surfactant molecules?
The surfactant molecules, the hairs that stick out, I forget how far they stick out. 10 nanometers, something like that. They're coiled up.
So smaller than the DNA?
They're smaller than the stiff DNA, than the double-stranded DNA. They're comparable in length to the single-stranded DNA, to the thickness of the single-stranded DNA layer. The way it's helping is this goes back to this idea I talked about yesterday, that a way of stabilizing colloids against aggregation is to coat them with a polymer, all right? And so these surfactants are polymers, actually, all right? The only thing is they're, the way they're attached to the particle surface is they just adsorb on the surface because it has a central block that doesn't like water, and so it attaches to the colloid. So it's rather weakly attached, but it's attached nonetheless, and that is sufficient for suppressing the nonspecific binding.
So the hydrophobic part is attached, adsorbed onto the
colloid. Right, yes.
And the hydrophilic part is
sticking out into the water. Yes. So it's a polymer brush, it's one that's only attached. There is steric repulsion due to the hydrophilic parts of the surfactant that are sticking into the water. That's what gives you the steric repulsion. Yeah?
You made all these beautiful lattices.
Ah, what about the diamond lattice? So the diamond lattice we haven't made yet. If we'd made it, you better believe that you'd hear about it from me.
My question is, what is it that prevents us?
All right, actually, I think we understand the problem pretty well. I also think that we have a way of overcoming the problem, and I'm even hopeful that in the next 6 months we'll make a diamond lattice. So what's the problem? All right, so we have tetrahedrally coordinated particles. That's good. All right, but when two patches come and they attach to each other, they can be in any orientation you want, which means the other patches can have arbitrary orientations with respect to each other. That's not true for carbon. These things sort of click into place, and they have preferred orientations. And those preferred orientations facilitate the forming of the diamond lattice. We don't have that. So I'll tell you what we're doing. One idea is to try, if you have a diamond lattice, there's all the space in between. So we're trying to fill that space in between with something that will encourage the other particles to go into a diamond lattice, all right? So we actually have a way of doing that. And so we tried it out on computer. We did a Brownian dynamics simulation, and on the computer, it assembles a diamond lattice lickety-split, no problem, all right? So we're now trying to do that in the laboratory. We've made one attempt so far. It didn't work. We have a couple of ideas as to why it didn't work, and we're trying to improve our technique. So I'm hopeful. But if I had done it, I would have talked about it. We haven't done it yet, but I do think there's a good chance that we will do it in the reasonably near future. I'm hoping so. Other questions? You're right.
So
right.
It's not very small, it's quite big.
Well, all right, so one thing I didn't mention here is patch size, all right? So if the patches are too big, more than one particle can attach to the same patch, and we've observed that. We do have some control over the size of the patches. There's two ways. We can control how much styrene we add to swell the particles, and we can also control the surface tension between the monomeric styrene and the polystyrene by adding surfactants. We do it both ways, and that gives us a control over patch size of about a factor of two or so. Okay, why don't we go to lunch?